Welcome, everyone. Thank you for joining us for the second day of our 7th annual neuroscience event. We will begin our last session of the event, Emerging Roles of the Immune System in Brain Function and Behavioral Processes. Inflammation has been linked to an increasing number of broad-ranging disorders. Various factors can cause the blood-brain barrier to become leaky, compromising the immune privileged status of the brain and altering neuroimmune communication. In this session, we investigate the possible roles of the immune system in brain function and explore the newest discoveries elucidating the effects of inflammation and infection on mental health. It is a pleasure to introduce our keynote speaker for this session. Dr. Michael Benros will be presenting infections and inflammation as possible causes of severe mental disorders, paving the way for new treatment targets. Dr. Benros is an MD, PhD, and has conducted his psychiatric and neurological residencies at the Copenhagen University Hospitals. He is a clinician and research leader in the biological causes of mental disorders at the Mental Health Centre Copenhagen at Copenhagen University Hospital. He has received several awards, including the prestigious Sapire Aude Research Leader Award from the Independent Research Fund, Denmark. He is recognized internationally for his ongoing involvement in clinical and epidemiological research into mental health, being at the forefront of the emerging field of psychiatric immunology, and has helped advancing the field through several landmark papers highlighting the association between immune-related factors and mental illness. For a complete biography on our speaker, please visit the Biography tab at the top of your screen. My name is Judy O'Rourke, and I will be your moderator for today's event. We're delighted to bring you this educational web seminar presented by LabRoots. LabRoots is the leading scientific social networking website and producer of educational virtual events and webinars. Before we begin, I would like to remind everyone this event is interactive. We encourage you to participate by submitting questions during the presentation. Simply click on the Ask a Question box located on the far left of your screen and type your questions into the drop-down box. Our speaker will respond to your questions following his presentation. This presentation is educational and thus offers free continuing education credits. Please click on the Continuing Education Credits tab located in the top right corner of the presentation window and follow the process to obtain your credits. Now, please join me in welcoming Dr. Michael Benros.
Thank you very much for the kind introduction. And my name is Dr. Michael Eriksen Benros from Mental Health Centre Copenhagen. And today I will present infections and inflammation as possible causes of severe mental disorders, paving the way for new treatment targets. And lately, the immune system have been associated with more and more diseases, here under also brain diseases and also psychiatric disorders, such as depression and schizophrenia. And previously, the brain was thought to be an immune-privileged site where the immune system couldn't actually reach the brain. But now we know that this is actually different and that the blood-brain barrier does not completely protect the brain from the immune system, but there's actually immune cells within the brain, and that the barrier also becomes leaky during periods with stress or head trauma or during a fetal life. And within recent years, we have also found out that there's a lymphatic system in the brain, also draining the brain from immune cells. So the field has actually advanced quite a lot within the recent years. And this is also displayed when we look at PubMed, which is the leading place to publish research articles. So if we study, if we write neuroinflammation on PubMed, we can't find studies before 1995. But as you can see in this curve, after 1995, the research on neuroinflammation is skyrocketing after these fundamental discoveries. And if you take it into a historical perspective, with the link between the immune system and mental disorders, it's actually not a new thing. It's actually a very old thing. And back in 1896, Krebelin actually suggested that schizophrenia could be an immunological disease, since they noticed that people with schizophrenia had more infections, but they didn't know which kind they were. And in 1905, the syphilis bacterium was identified, but we didn't have any treatment for it at that point. So Valmer Jarvik received the Nobel Prize in 1927 for his malaria treatment, where he actually induced another infection in these individuals, so infected them with malaria. And the immune response provoked by the malaria infection actually cured the syphilis infection in some of the patients. But it was also a dangerous treatment, since malaria was also a lethal disease in itself. In 1945, Fleming was awarded the Nobel Prize for the invention of penicillin, which is one of the greatest discoveries in medical history, but actually also a very important discovery in psychiatry, because during the next 10 years, neurosyphilis in the psychiatric wards gradually disappeared due to this new treatment. And it's actually estimated that 1/3 of all patients admitted to psychiatric hospitals at that point actually were suffering from a neurosyphilis, a syphilis infection in the brain. And at the same point, there was also other important discoveries, such as the introduction of the current antipsychotics and antidepressants. But since then, only a little have happened in the treatment. We have, of course, also got the treatment of ECT of brain disorders, but still 30% of the patients are currently non-responders. But if we look at the immunological angle, the late years have showed us that in 1995, the brain was not actually a complete immune-privileged site. And the genetic studies have learned us that there are links between the immune system and schizophrenia, but also lately with depression. And several of our register studies, which I will present, have also shown links between the immune system and immune disorders with severe mental disorders. And this discovery of NMDA receptor encephalitis have also spiked this interest, where it's an antibody against the NMDA receptor in the brain, which can cause psychotic symptoms, but also neurological symptoms. And if you put it into an evolutionary perspective, you could also say that our interaction with the immune system, well, it was our best friend in the old days, since it protected us from lethal infections. But now when we go to more modern days, where we are not exposed to the same infectious load, the immune system can also become our enemy in some cases. For instance, there's a rise of autoimmune diseases and also allergic diseases such as asthma in the modern society, which is believed to be associated with a less exposure to these infections. So our immune system might overreact when we meet an infection. So this could also be the case for depression, for instance. It has been hypothesized. And when we look at autoimmunity and brain-reactive antibodies, many autoimmune diseases are associated with an increased prevalence of neuropsychiatric symptoms. And some autoantibodies can react against the brain and cause psychosis, but also many other psychiatric symptoms. And infections and cancer can also cause autoimmunity, and that is when the immune system tries to fight off the infection or cancer and then produces a too large response with antibodies that can also react against the brain. And animal studies have shown that if you induce these brain-reactive antibodies into the brain of this rat, for instance, it would develop no psychiatric symptoms. And if you then induce the same brain-reactive antibodies in the periphery, nothing will happen until you also induces a substance called LPS that causes inflammation and increases the permeability of the blood-brain barrier, after which the animal would develop the same neuropsychiatric symptoms. So it seems of important for these brain-reactive antibodies to actually reach the brain before being pathogenic. And this is to further explain the autoimmune encephalitis phenotype, which is here exemplified by the anti-NMDA receptor encephalitis. And it was discovered in 2007. And it's an autoimmune disease with antibodies directed against the NMDA receptor. And 70% of these patients have initial psychiatric symptoms, and most are followed by a neurological involvement, and ultimately they are protected cognitive and behavioral symptoms many years after. And on patients with psychosis, there's only been studies of the blood where between 6 and 10% of the patients have NMDA antibodies, but no large-scale studies have been done on the CSF, which is the liquid that surrounds the brain, and they actually have to enter the brain before being pathogenic. So this is still a question mark within psychiatric disorders, how big is the role of these antibodies. And it's also important to say that this disease responds to immunosuppressive treatment. And studies have also shown signs of inflammation in the brain using brain scans. And here you can see that the individuals with schizophrenia have higher levels of inflammation in the brain than the healthy individuals. And these studies are done with a PET ligand, which shows the activity of the microglia in the brain, which are the brain's immune cells. And in the middle, you can see people that are high risk of schizophrenia. So they're in the middle regarding this brain inflammation. However, this is the study that fits the best with the hypothesis, whereas there are many other studies that have shown conflicting evidence. And it's a new method, so it's still on its way, but it's exciting to follow. And the following, I will show how we have studied this utilizing the nationwide Danish registers, where we can record a lot of events here in Denmark. So every time an individual goes to the hospital and are diagnosed with an infection or autoimmune, for instance, it's registered, and we can follow people over time with our registers to look at when they and if they get a mental disorder such as schizophrenia or depression. And we also have biobanks where we can get DNA samples to study the genetic association. And we have a nationwide prescription database, so all prescribed medicines are actually also recorded. And all these data can be linked using a unique personal identifier. And the first study is a study on autoimmune diseases and infections as risk factors for schizophrenia. And here we have a cohort of 3.5 million Danish individuals. And during our study period, there were 39,000 incident schizophrenia cases. And here we show that autoimmune disease increased the risk of schizophrenia with 45%. But when we take away the effect of infections, it's 29%. And infections themselves increase the risk of schizophrenia by 60%. And people that are exposed to both infections and autoimmune diseases, they have an increased risk of schizophrenia by 2.25 times. And as you can see in the confidence intervals, they're all pretty narrow, which is due to we have such so many cases. And we also show that infections and autoimmune diseases increase the risk of schizophrenia in a dose-response relationship. And as you can see in the last blue bar, there are people with autoimmune diseases and 3 and more hospital contacts for infections. They have almost 3.5 times increased risk of schizophrenia. But as you can also see on the red bars, which are people that only have infections, infections themselves also increases the risk of schizophrenia in a dose-response relationship. And here we divided the autoimmune diseases into the following group of autoimmune diseases that have a suspected presence of brain-reactive antibodies, and they display a higher risk of schizophrenia than the remaining groups of autoimmune diseases. And when we look at the type of infections, the risks of schizophrenia seems to be highest for sepsis and hepatitis infections, but actually most of these severe infections requiring hospital contacts were associated with increased risks. And also infections in the brain, CNS infections, increased the risk of schizophrenia, but not as much as expected, but we will come back to that point later on. And this is another study where we only followed people from birth, so all exposures were recorded. And in this study, we had 3,000 incident cases of schizophrenia. And here we were able to look at the type of infection also. And we showed that bacterial infections displayed the highest risk of schizophrenia and increased the risk by 73%. And this also makes sense since bacterial infections would cause the greatest inflammatory response in the body, which would make it most likely to actually reach the brain and cause damage. But when we look at relevant for depression, there's something called sickness behavior, which you can induce in animals if you induce inflammation with pro-inflammatory cytokines such as IL-1 or TNF-alpha. And they can induce symptoms of fatigue, reduced appetite, negative mood, sleep disturbances, impaired cognitions. And this has also been done in healthy individuals with smaller dosage. And all these symptoms are actually very overlapping with symptoms of depression. So these symptoms can actually be induced by the immune cells. And in the next studies, we looked at autoimmune diseases and infections as risk factors for mood disorders. And here we had 91,000 cases of incident affective disorders diagnosis and a cohort of 3.5 million Danish individuals. And here we showed that autoimmune diseases increased the risk of mood disorders by 45%, and infections increased the risk by 62%. And individuals that had both infections and autoimmune diseases had an increased risk of mood disorders by 2.35 times. And also for mood disorders, there was a dose-response relationship. And the last blue bars show people with autoimmune disease and 8 or more hospital contacts for infections, and they had an over 4 times increased risk of mood disorders. And again, the blue bars, the red bars, are people that only had infections that also increased the risk of mood disorders in a dose-response relationship. And if you instead looked at people with hospital contacts for different infections, we show that people with 5 or more different hospital contacts for infections had a 5 times increased risk of mood disorders. And again, we also made the same grouping of the autoimmune diseases with suspected presence of brain reactive antibodies, which displayed a further increased risk than the remaining autoimmune diseases. And when we looked at the localization of the infection, it was again sepsis and hepatitis infections that displayed the highest risk. And sepsis infections is infections in the blood, which is most likely to increase the permeability of the blood-brain barrier since the immune component actually reaches the brain. And also urological infections showed a high risk. And here in the subsequent studies, we looked at the less severe infections not requiring hospital contacts. So here we included the prescription of anti-infective agents for infections treated at the general practitioner. So here the reference group is quite different. It's actually individuals that has not been treated with anti-infective agents by the general practitioner, so they are more healthy than in the prior study. And here we show that people treated with anti-infective agents have an increased risk of schizophrenia by 37% and for affective disorders by 64%. And if they also had a hospital contact with infections, the risk of schizophrenia were increased by 2.5 times and for affective disorders by 2.59 times. And when we look at the type of infection treated, we show that the more severe infections that required treatment with broad-spectrum antibiotics were the one that displayed the highest risk. And this table, it's mutually adjusted, so we can also see that viral infections or parasitic infections were actually not associated with increased risk. So it's not only that going to your general practitioner that are associated with increased risk. And also here we displayed dose response relationship, particularly regarding depression. And in the next study, we looked at a specific infection called the streptococcal infections, which has also been linked with an increased risk of mental disorders. And it has been hypothesized that the surface of the streptococcal infections have a molecular similarity with the basal ganglia in the brain. So therefore, it has been associated with tics and OCD symptoms. So if the immune system tries to fight off the streptococcal infection, it can overreact and produce too many antibodies against this molecular surface agents, and then they can cross-react with the brain tissue theoretically. So here we looked at a positive streptococcal infections were associated with a 16% increased risk of mental disorders and a 49% increased risk of OCD and a 35% increased risk of tic disorders when comparing to individuals with no test. But in the subsequent study, we also introduced an active comparator group that are people that were tested, but tested negative for streptococcal infections and hence had another infection. And that's the middle gray columns in this graph. But we showed that individuals with streptococcal infections had higher risk of any mental disorders also when comparing to this group with a negative test but another infection, and also regarding OCD, but for tic disorders, there were no difference. And we can also see out of this graph that the other infections also increased the risk. And here we did a meta-analysis of all studies investigating people that were diagnosed with PANDAS compared to control children with tics and OCD, since it has been hypothesized that it was these PANDAS children, their exacerbations were due to new streptococcal infections, but we actually didn't find any evidence of that holding water. But we did show that the children currently diagnosed with PANDAS, they have an increased risk of neuropsychiatric exacerbations. So this means that these individuals diagnosed with PANDAS are the ones with more severe symptoms than the control groups in these studies. So we did a new study where we actually looked at all mental disorders as an outcome in children. And here we showed that infections were a risk factor for virtually all mental disorders in children, and particularly ADHD, but also anxiety disorders had increased risk, and also personality disorders. And in the next study, I promise we will get back to CNS infections. So we did a more specific study on CNS infections, where we adjusted for if you had other infections to look at the specific effects. And here we showed that CNS infections, which is an infection in the brain, increased the risk of mental disorders by 36%. And when we look at the localization of the infection, where does it cause most damage? It shows that encephalitis infections, which is infection in the brain compared to meningitis, which is the surroundings of the brains, we show that encephalitis were associated with an 81% increased risk of mental disorders. And when looking whether it was bacterial or viral infections, we show that the viral infections were associated with the highest risk of mental disorders. And this was a bit in contrary to when we looked at peripheral infections, where it was bacterial infections that were associated with the highest risk of mental disorders. And this could be due to they produce the highest inflammatory response in the periphery, which makes it more likely to reach the brain. But when the infection are actually in the brain, it seems as the viral infections are more associated with mental disorders. And here we show the type of infections in the brain. And it was tuberculosis that displayed one of the highest risk, and herpes virus, and adenovirus, but all these viruses and bacterial CNS infections displayed here showed increased risk of mental disorders. And we're looking at the type of mental disorders. We show that the highest risk after CNS infections were for organic mental disorders, that had increased risk of 6.3 times. And this also explains why the risk for schizophrenia and affective disorders wasn't further, wasn't as high as we would expect, since these individuals are actually diagnosed with an organic mental disorder instead. And we also show that there's a large association with mental retardations, but the risk were increased by 3.5 times. When we're looking at time since the last CNS infections, we show that the 6 months after CNS infections, individuals actually have almost 45 times increased risk of mental disorders. And this is a very high estimate in epidemiological research. So therefore, it looks as in the long term, there's no increased risk, but there actually is. It's just because it's so high in the beginning after the CNS infections. So there's a clear temporal associations between CNS infections and mental disorders. And also for the CNS infections, we show a dose-response relationship with the number associated with the increased risk of mental disorders. And here we studied the associations between infections and cognitive ability in healthy individuals. And in Denmark, males attend conscription for the military, and at that day they have an IQ test performed. So there we could look at prior infections if they are associated with a lower score on this IQ test as a measure of cognition. And here we show that infections associated with a decreased score on the IQ test, and particularly for CNS infections. And we also showed that the number of infections prior to the prescription were associated with a lower cognitive ability. And if an individual has been hospitalized 5 or more times for infections, they actually have almost 10 points lower on the IQ score. So that's some difference. And when we look at CNS infections and school performance, we show that individuals with CNS infections actually also have half the chance of completing compulsory schools. So it seems to affect also the cognition in the way of school performance. And when we looked at CNS infections and mental retardation, we show a dose response. So the higher the risk were, the more profound cognitive affected an individual were. Whereas for profound mental retardation, there was an increased risk of almost 20 times after a CNS infection. And when looking at suicide as an outcome instead, we also here show that the number of infections are associated with a higher risk of suicide. And we show that the severity of the infection matters. So here we looked at the number of days in treatment for infections. So the more severe the infection have been, so you require more days hospitalized, the higher the risk of suicide in these individuals. And another cause of brain inflammation is head injury, and actually used in the animal models to induce nerve inflammation where they're exposed to traumatic brain injury. So here we looked at the associations between head injury and mental disorders. And this is actually also an old story, which is back from 1848, that Phineas Cage was a railway worker and got this metal stick to his head. And after that, he developed mental problems, which also written several books about. And if you look at the risk of schizophrenia after a traumatic brain injury, the risk is increased by 60%. And similarly for unipolar depression, a little less for bipolar disorders, whereas for organic mental disorders, the risk were increased by almost 4.5 times. And here we also used an active comparator group, which are the blue columns, that are people that were admitted to hospitals with fractures not involving the skull. And also when comparing to these, there were higher risk for schizophrenia and depression and organic mental disorders, but actually not for bipolar disorders. So here the comparison with accident proneness, it seems that these individuals are more accident prone than the others. And we also looked at the risk of dementia after a head injury. And we showed that the risk of dementia were increased by 21%, and particularly with the temporal proximity of the head injury. And it's also a topic which has been discussed much in the media lately regarding NFL players, which are the American Football League, which are suffering from mental problems afterwards and also suicidal ideation. And it's also been discussed regarding boxers. And we also showed that TBI associated with an increased suicide risk, particularly in the short time period after the TBI, but there was an increased risk of suicide by 3.6 times. Another cause of inflammation and brain inflammation can be cancers. And here we did a study of all people with a first-time admission to a mental health hospital. And we showed that the risk of having an undiagnosed cancer at the point of admission were increased by 2.6 times the first month after admission. And the risk were particularly increased for brain tumors, where they had a 19 times increased risk the first month, and also for small cell lung cancer. And for brain tumors, they can, of course, press on the brain structures causing symptoms, but they can also cause the immunological reaction in the brain. And small cell lung cancers are known to induce paraneoplastic symptoms, where antibodies try to fight off the cancer, but can cross-react with the brain and cause psychiatric and neurological symptoms. And the group at the highest risk were individuals with a first-time admission between 50 and 64 years of age, which had a four times elevated risk of cancer, and a 37 times elevated risk of brain cancer, which is quite markedly. And it was actually one out of 63 persons above 50 years of age that, with a first-time psychiatric contact, that had an undetected cancer, and 10% of these were brain cancer. So it's important to look out for as a psychiatrist. And what are the prevalences of these potential risk factors? They are actually quite common. And a previous hospital contact for infections had occurred in 23% of people with schizophrenia and in 32% of people with mood disorders. And 96% had prior antibiotic use before the schizophrenia or mood disorder diagnosis. Streptococcal infections had occurred prior to 38% of mental disorders and prior to 51% of OCD. And prior to 45% of tic disorders, and 5 to 6% of people with schizophrenia and mood disorders, they have a hospital contact with an autoimmune disease, and 11 to 12% had a previous hospital contact for a traumatic brain injury prior to being diagnosed with schizophrenia and mood disorders. And when looking at infections during pregnancy, this has also been exercise to be associated with mental disorders, since the maternal immune response could affect the fetus and the subsequent brain functions. And we show that infections during pregnancy were associated with a 38% increased risk of mental disorders in the child if the mother had hospital contacts for infections during pregnancy, and a 40% increased risk if she were treated with anti-infective agents by the general practitioner. But we also show that these risk estimates were quite similarly before or after the pregnancy period, which suggests that they are not very specific to this. So it could also be a genetic vulnerability of requiring infections. And we showed that the red lines are maternal infections, that the number of maternal infections were associated with mental disorders in child in a dose-response relationship during pregnancy. But here, when we put the periods outside and both before or after the pregnancy period, they show quite similar patterns. But this is overall broad inflammation, but there could still be specific infections or antibodies, maternal antibodies that are associated with increased risk, And here we did a study of maternal CNS reactive antibodies during pregnancy and showed that mothers that has the Caspar-2 antibodies, their children had an increased risk of mental retardation. So there could still be a specific effect of some of these on the developing brain. And when we look at the reverse temporal association, as we have done until now, and look at the risk of autoimmune diseases after the diagnosis with schizophrenia, we actually show that the associations are bidirectional. So if you have a schizophrenia diagnosis but no infections, your risk of a subsequent autoimmune disease are increased by 32%. And infections themselves also increase the risk of autoimmune diseases by 75%. And this fits very well that the primary etiological agents for autoimmune diseases are expected to be genetic factors and infections. And we show that if people that both have schizophrenia and infections, they had a subsequent increased risk of autoimmune diseases by 2.7 times. And there was a multiplicative interaction between having schizophrenia and infections, which suggests that there's a biological relationship. I'm looking at the time after the schizophrenia diagnosis, and we stratify the results for people with schizophrenia and infections and people without. The blue bars are people with infections. The risk of autoimmune diseases keeps to be elevated over time, whereas the red are people with schizophrenia but no infections. The risk of autoimmune diseases actually decreases to a non-significant level 15 or more years after the diagnosis. So there could also be genetic associations behind these displayed associations between infections and autoimmune diseases with the mental disorders, where polygenic risk scores or immune-related genes could explain some of this association. And if you look into the family histories, a family history of schizophrenia increases the risk of autoimmune diseases in the child by 6%, and below are displayed the ones with the significant associations. And there's also the reverse associations, that a family history of autoimmune diseases are associated with increased risk of schizophrenia by 10%. And this next study, we used the genetic information from the individuals in a smaller cohort of 1,700 cases and 1,700 controls. And here we show that when additionally adjusting for the polygenic risk score for schizophrenia, this does not affect the prior shown associations between infections and schizophrenia, which is still elevated with a 41% increased risk. But when stratifying this polygenic risk scores into quartiles, we show that the last red bars are people in the highest in the fourth quartile with the highest load of polygenic risk score for schizophrenia. And here we show that people without infections, they had an increased risk of schizophrenia based on this polygenic risk scores by 2.3 times, whereas people that also had infections, they had an increased risk of schizophrenia by 3.4 times. So there was an additive effect of both infections and the genes for schizophrenia on the subsequent risk. So in the next study, we did a GWAS of infections on a cohort of 65,000 individuals. But here we didn't find any GWAS significant hits. And infections are also mainly transmitted from person to person. So it's more in environmental exposure than genetic. But still, we could find a polygenic risk score for infection, which predicted infection status, but only explained 5% of the variants. So it only explained 5% of the cases of infection. So this seems as the genetic contribution is a small contribution to acquiring infections. And when doing the GWAS, we also investigated if there were genetic correlation between infections and mental disorders. And here we actually found a genetic correlation of 0.5, which is actually a moderate correlation. So there seems to also be a genetic component explaining some of these differences, but only a small part of it, since the SNP heritability of infections was only 4%. When going back to the immune markers, we did a study where we looked at people at their diagnosis for schizophrenia, bipolar, or depression, how their blood levels were. And we showed that they had increased levels of CRP in the blood, whereas the highest levels were observed for bipolar disorders, where they have an average of 3.5, particularly during manic states, where it was 3.9, whereas schizophrenia had 3.1, and depression it was 2.8. And if you compare to a normal person, that would have a CRP level below 1. So there seems to be elevated levels of inflammatory component at diagnosis. And these elevated CRP levels were also associated with higher mortality rates in the individuals. So if you have a CRP levels above 10, there was a over 2 times increased risk of dying subsequently. So these are important things to actually watch out for as clinicians and look for somatic diseases underlying these numbers. And then going to CSF studies, because many of the studies have primarily focused on peripheral infections, but as I've explained, it's more likely that it has to reach the brain to actually cause symptoms. So we did a systematic review and meta-analysis of all CSF studies conducted on people with mental disorders, and we found 112 CSF studies through time, but only 32% of these studies actually included healthy controls, so you can say anything about the differences. And very few of these studies investigated the same parameters, so it's quite difficult to do a meta-analysis. However, we could show that there was signs of increased permeability of the blood-brain barrier in both people with schizophrenia and mood disorders compared to healthy controls. And there were also elevated cytokine levels of IL-6 and IL-8, particularly for schizophrenia. And two studies investigated how many individuals were re-diagnosed after the CSF test, and it was actually between 3.2 to 6% of the individuals that received a new and a immune-related disease diagnosis instead of their psychiatric disorders. So it's actually very important to consider these tests in the clinical measurements. And why is this important? It's also important because there's actually a lot of treatment possibilities targeting the immune system. So therefore, we did a meta-analysis of all studies published, which are randomized placebo-controlled trials of depression or depressive symptoms in individuals treated with anti-inflammatory agents compared to placebo. And here we showed that there was a significant effect of the anti-inflammatory treatment, particularly for people with clinical depression, where there was an effect size of a SMD of 0.54, which is actually a medium effect size, and a bit smaller effect for people that only had depressive symptoms, where the effect size was 0.27. And here we did a distinction between anti-inflammatory NSAIDs versus cytokine inhibitors, and showing that the beneficial effects of NSAIDs were 0.27 SMD, whereas cytokine inhibitors had a beneficial effect of 0.38, which is a medium effect. And now we have actually just published a new study updating our prior analysis. And this time, we could actually include almost 10,000 patients in randomized controlled trials. And here we showed a standard mean difference of 0.49. So it's actually a moderate effect of anti-inflammatory treatment on depression, both as mono-treatment, but also as add-on to current antidepressant treatment. So it could be something to watch out for the future. And here we are on the way with a new meta-analysis for psychosis, where we studied all studies looking at anti-inflammatory agents versus placebo for patients with schizophrenia and psychosis. And also these studies showed efficacy of anti-inflammatory agents for schizophrenia and psychosis. And there are also case studies out investigating people with the specific antibodies against the brain. And here they have shown the associations between the anti-NMDA autoband antibody levels and the treatment for psychotic symptoms. And when they have the star on this picture, they are actually getting treatment with immunotherapy. And this case report show that some people with these antibodies benefit from immunotherapy, but large-scale studies are still lacking on this, of course. So there seems to be possible prevention and treatment. And we have to remember that mental disorders are associated with increased mortality, and it's primarily due to physical diseases. So a thorough physical examination is very important in our patients. And if immune components are actually proved to be involved in prodromal symptoms, early treatment might prevent long-term disease course. So, and there could be new possible treatments for immune-related subgroups of mental disorders, which could be anti-inflammatory agents such as NSAIDs or cytokine inhibitors or immunosuppressive treatment if specific immune alterations are observed. But we are not there yet of actually identifying these subgroups, but that are what we are working on. And I mean, psychiatry has also moved a good way the last year, and this is a test of how it actually were in the past. So if you look in year 2000, people admitted to a mental health department, it was only less than 20% that actually had a blood test of the CRP or leukocyte and also of the metabolic test. And this has luckily increased to time where increased awareness of this to in clinicians, but we are still lagging part behind from where we should be. Should be everyone admitted that are actually thoroughly physically investigated for other contributing factors to the illness. And the take-home message of my talk is that infections and autoimmune diseases and head trauma increases the risk of mental disorders in a dose-response relationship. And at diagnosis, there are increased levels of peripheral inflammation, increased blood-brain barrier permeability, and increased CSF cytokine levels. And it was actually between 3 and 6% of the individuals that were re-diagnosed after a CSF test, highlighting the importance of thorough somatic investigations of our patients. And genetic studies have shown association between mental disorders and immune-related genes. And lastly, immunosuppressive agents has a moderate effect on depression and psychosis. However, we're still lacking RCTs based on immune-related biomarkers, so we can actually identify specific subgroups which would benefit the most of this potential treatment. So I would like to thank you for your attention. And thank all my collaborators for these studies from the Mental Health Centre of Copenhagen and the Centre for Register-Based Research at Aarhus University and the Institute of Biological Psychiatry and the State Serum Institute and also Johns Hopkins University in the US. Okay, thank you very much. And if you have any questions, you're very welcome to raise them to me. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Benros, for that informative presentation. I would like to pose some audience questions to you. The first one is, so where should we go from here? Should we start treating the patients with anti-inflammatory treatment?
Thank you, and it's a very intriguing question. And when we have these numbers from our meta-analysis, it feels like we should actually start this treatment now. But still, I think it's lacking that we need to identify the subgroups that will actually benefit from this treatment the most, since it's probably not all treatment with all people with a depression or psychosis that will benefit them. So we need to conduct studies to identify immune-related subgroups of the individuals who benefit from this treatment the most. And also, I think big pharma studies are still lacking to identify the optimal dose and the length of treatment and which of these different possibility for treatment should actually be used. So we are still waiting for that, but I think there's a big potential for this new treatment actually being a part of the psychiatric treatment in the future when we have done this groundwork, if it shows to be successful.
Should we start using cerebrospinal fluid tests as a routine in psychiatry?
Yeah, it's a very good question. And it's something that we should consider in the clinic. And it's a very cheap test. And it can actually rule out inflammation in the brain in these individuals, which can be treated. And it needs to be treated before it can actually cause damage to the brain. So I'm actually of the opinion that we should consider it now. But we are conducting a large study here in Denmark on people that are newly diagnosed with schizophrenia or other psychotic disorders, but also mood disorders compared to healthy controls, to investigate if it's something that we should actually implement in the clinic. So we're still waiting for our results, but at least I think it's something that clinicians should consider very carefully if it's actually needed. And we should very likely do more of these tests than we're doing currently in the psychiatric treatment.
Well, thank you. Any other questions that were submitted today for our speaker will be followed up via email. Thank you again, Dr. Benros, for your presentation. And thank you, LabRoots, for making today's educational webcast possible. Before we go, I want to let everyone know that this webcast will be available for on-demand viewing through June 14th, 2019. That's all for now. Thank you for joining us, and we will see you next time. Goodbye.